I need to tell you about the anime arc level nonsense that's happening with the Mongo Bleed disclosure. So this is CV2025-14847. Mismatched link fields in zlib compressed protocol headers may allow a read of uninitialized heap memory by an unauthenticated client. This allows for a regular user with access to the database, no auth whatsoever, to read pretty much anything that came from a previous database operation, just whenever. They could just read it. Now, it would depend on the operations that were done for what things you'd be getting, but we'll talk more about how this works in just a moment. This is now fixed, but before it was fixed, affected every version of MongoDB since 2017. And whilst supported versions have been fixed, there are some EOL versions of MongoDB that still have the vulnerability and are very possibly still in production. If you happen to be using one of those EOL versions, stop doing that. Here we have a post from VX Underground, and this is where we get into the absolute mess of what is going on. So there was some inaccurate early reporting, which created a bit more confusion about this than there otherwise should have been. So, the first group of individuals exploited a Rainbow Six Siege service, allowing them to ban players, modify inventory, a bunch of other things like that. These individuals did not touch user data, unsure if they even could. They gifted roughly 339 billion worth of in-game currency to players. Ubisoft will perform a rollback to undo the damages. I believe they've already started doing that rollback. They're probably annoyed, and that's that. Now, the reason why this is involved here is initially, people thought that Rainbow Six issue was caused by Mongo Bleed, and a lot of people now have been running with that being the thing that happened. That is not what happened, and the Rainbow Six issue is something entirely unrelated. That did happen, a lot of people watched it happen, but it wasn't caused by Mongo Bleed. A second group of individuals, unrelated to the first group of individuals, exploited a MongoDB instance from Ubisoft using Mongo Bleed, which allowed them, in some capacity, to pivot to an internal Git repository. They exfiltrated a large portion of Ubisoft's internal source code. They assert it is data from the 90s to present, including software development kits, multiplayer services, etc. I have high to medium confidence this is true. I've confirmed this with multiple parties. Except that's not actually what happened. So, what actually happened here is they claim to have Ubisoft source code, okay? That claim is still fair. They claimed it was from Mongo Bleed. That part is a lie. They have verifiable internal things from Ubisoft, though. What appears to have happened here is they exfiltrated some stuff from Ubisoft, and then Mongo Bleed came along, and then basically used that as a red herring to distract from whatever thing they actually did. A third group of individuals claimed to have compromised Ubisoft and exfiltrated user data by exploiting MongoDB via Mongo Bleed. This group is trying to extort Ubisoft. They have a name for their extortion group and are active on Telegram. Turns out, these guys were just liars. Just nothing they said was true whatsoever, and they're using fake data to try to intimidate Ubisoft and Ubisoft customers to pay them money. They're all lying. So, this is a different group from Group 2. Group 2 does appear to have some verifiable internal data. Group 3 is pretending to be Group 2. A fourth group of individuals assert the second group of individuals are lying and state the second group has had access to Ubisoft internal code for a while. However, They state the second group is trying to hide behind the first group to masquerade as them and give them a reason to leak the source code in totality. The first group and fourth group are frustrated by this. Now, there is also a fifth group. Group 5 appeared today and presented a comprehensive breakdown on the Ubisoft Rainbow Six Siege and other conflicts. Group 5 illustrated step-by-step how all actions were performed. Group 5 unveiled exactly how Group 2 managed to get access to Ubisoft internals with photographic evidence. Group 5 also provided code demonstrating how Group 1 did many things as well as other things not reported. Group 5 has a big... Group 5 has a big swinging dick and isn't effing around. Group 5 is pretty hardcore, not even memeing. They're very intelligent and calculated in what they say and do. Group 5 probably make and sell cheats for Ubisoft games and are very talented reverse engineers. Ubisoft is well aware of Group 1, 2, 4, and 5. Group 5 also provided a comprehensive breakdown on how Ubisoft knows things. All the groups listed except Group 3 know each other and operate loosely together in some capacity. It's basically a hardcore community of gaming Ubisoft nerds. Group 3 isn't involved because Group 3 are basically LARPing. So where we stand right now is that MongoBleed had absolutely nothing to do with the Ubisoft issue. The Ubisoft issue did happen, especially the Rainbow Six stuff. Probably they had some exfiltrated data as well, but that wasn't related to MongoBleed. Basically, there was a whole big mess. There was a very conveniently timed exploit, and that basically became the red herring that everyone blamed. So no one publicly knows what actually happened with Ubisoft at this point, but that was a whole mess unto itself. With all of that out of the way, now we can talk about the very real CVE, because whilst MongoBleed had absolutely nothing to do with that, it is a real CVE, it is a real serious problem, and yeah. Now, some people, for some reason, were not happy with when the disclosure was made, because it was disclosed just before Christmas, and apparently security research is supposed to just stop around Christmas. There's this great post here. My threat model includes hackers don't hack on weekends. Hackers only hack between 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. my time zone. And hackers don't hack during Western vacation periods. This is not, like, this is not how vulnerabilities work. When one is found, if someone wants to publish it, it doesn't matter if it's Christmas, if it's Easter, if it's your birthday. Get over it. You're probably not even someone who's involved in security research, or if you are, you're someone who is, like, very new to this and has no idea how anything goes. So, yeah. Anyway, let's talk about how the vulnerability actually happens. Exploit part 1. The first part of the exploit is to get the server to wrongfully think that an overly large OP message is coming. So this contains a BSON or binary JSON message. An attacker can send a falsely large, uncompressed size field, say 1 megabyte, when in reality, the underlying message is 1 kilobyte uncompressed. This will make the server allocate a 1 megabyte buffer in memory to decompress the message into, and this is totally fine. The bug here is that once finished decompressing, the server does not check the actual size of the uncompressed payload. So if you have a 1 kilobyte uncompressed message, now you have an extra 999 kilobytes of unused space. And this is just unreferenced heap garbage. Now, in a lot of languages, this wouldn't be a problem at all. In a lot of languages. Regardless, you shouldn't do it because you're just wasting memory and you shouldn't trust the user input on the size of a thing. You should go and verify the actual size. We're not verifying the size, we're just going with whatever the user says. In every programming language, when a variable in the code goes out of scope, the runtime marks the memory it previously took up as available. In most modern languages, the memory gets zeroed out. In other words, the old bytes that used to take up the space get deleted. In C and C++, that doesn't happen. When you allocate memory via malloc, you get whatever was previously there. And What do you think MongoDB is written in? Since MongoDB is written in C++, that unreferenced heap garbage part can represent anything that was in memory from previous operations, including clear text passwords and credentials, session tokens and API keys, customer data and other private information, database configs and system info, Docker paths, and client IP addresses. Now, this wouldn't be that big of a deal if there was no way to get this information back to the attacker. If this is just what was being done internally on the server, you shouldn't be doing this. It's very bad practice. You're probably gonna break something, but it's fine. You will survive. The problem comes in part two. Now the server has wrongfully allocated some potentially sensitive data to the input message, the only thing left is for the attacker to somehow get the server to return the data. This is way easier than it should be. So C famously uses null terminated strings. A null terminated string means that a null byte is used to mark the end of the string. Easy enough. The way such strings get parsed is very simple. The deserializer reads every character until it finds a null terminator. Now the first field of the BSON message denotes the type of RPC the command is. This is a remote procedure call. As such, the first thing a server does when handling an incoming message over the wire is parse the first field. Because fields are strings, and strings are null terminated C strings, the deserializing logic in the MongoDB server parses the field until the first null terminator is found. An attacker can send a compressed, invalid BSON object that does not contain a null terminator. This forces the server to continue scanning through foreign data in the wrongfully allocated memory buffer until it finds the first null terminator, which might be at the end of a password or the end of an API key or something else that, you know, you shouldn't be stopping on. Again, this wouldn't be a problem if it didn't send the information back to the attacker. However, because you've sent invalid BSON to be incredibly helpful, the server responds with an error message and responds with an error message containing the BSON field that caused the error. The BSON field that you didn't have a null terminator on that is now stopping at the next null terminator, in this context, on a password. At the root cause of this, all of this is caused by one, just listening to the user for how much data they want, and two, not properly ending your strings. Reporting back to the user with the field without verifying that that field is actually safe to return. Obviously, running this once isn't very useful, but any serious attacker is going to run this hundreds or thousands of times and exfiltrate as much data as they possibly can. They can't control the data that is being stored in the heap, but they can just keep hitting the server over and over and over again until they get as much data as possible. As for the PR that introduced the issue, it would be this one right here, which has had a good comment added to it after the fact. And I guess some people happened to discover it. And that PR was from May 2017. This means that roughly from version 3.6.0, any publicly accessible MongoDB instance has been vulnerable to this. It is unknown whether the exploit was known and exploited by actors prior to its disclosure. Given the simplicity, though, I bet it was. Very, very likely others were exploiting this. I really doubt that this has not been used in prior attacks. As of the exploit's disclosure, which happened on the 19th of December, it has been a race to patch the database. Sifting through the Git history, it seems like the fix was initially committed on the 17th of December. It was merged a full 5 days after in the public repo on the 22nd of December. And it's a pretty simple fix. Just, you know, actually checking the size of the thing rather than just listening to the size it claims to be. In any case, because there's no official timeline posted, members of the community like me have to guess. As of writing 10 days later on December 28th, 2025, Mongo have still not properly addressed the issue publicly. Let's have a look. We are now on the 30th of December, and Oh, wait, wait, did they just publish one? Oh my god, they just did. Okay, it took them a little bit, but they finally actually did it. They were pretty late. I don't know why they were so late to it. And initially they were saying, at this time we have no evidence that this issue has been exploited or that any customer data has been compromised. I am assuming they changed their mind and realized, oh yeah, this actually is a pretty big deal. Maybe we should at least post something. Now, just to cap things off, I'll leave you with this video. This is from 15 years ago, and people have rediscovered it, and it is the funniest thing. Just, all I'll say is it's about 5 minutes of explaining why web scale is not a justifiable reason to use MongoDB. And sure, look, MongoDB's not bad, but it is a funny video, so check that one out. So, MongoBleed. We're going to be hearing about this for a little bit longer, and I'm sure there's going to be some things that are discovered that turns out to be, maybe MongoBleed was involved. And I'm sure there are some EOL deployments out there that have not been dealt with yet. So, anyone who's working in this space, I guess, I hope you had a good Christmas and hope you have a good New Year's, because you're going to be working a bit of overtime. Anyway, if you liked the video, go like the video. Go subscribe as well. If you really like the video and you want to become one of these amazing people over here, check out the Patreon, subscribe, Stelly Berape, linked in the description down below. That's going to be it for me and oh man. What is this?